¿Cómo le va? Y luego le una pluviación directa. Pues sí, llueve, ya sale. Ya va con la gran pico de día, para el COVID, ¿no? Entonces, es un nivel estándar de semana. Apart from that, they are conducting a very necessary test. I'm conducting 30 lectures from 1978. We are at that. We are at 2,778 lectures. The audience said that. The my problem is number one. And then we'll check out of it. I can tell them. Yes, the man with the right, yes, 40 lectures. The lectures, so it's our years today. Yeah, it's very difficult to connect with lectures. And such a lecture, 2,778 lectures, is shortly going to be delivered by Dr. P. Satish Chandra, Senior Professor of Neurology, former Director and Vice Chancellor Nimans, a very fine person, very fine engineer, very fine gentleman. From our point of view, Mother Institution, he was going here actually. And he gives a lecture on epilepsy and love. Today, on behalf of all these institutions, you and me, I extend a very cordial welcome to Dr. P. Satish Chandra. Was senior professor of neurology and was previously heading the prestigious National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences in March in Bangalore. A director and vice chancellor from June 2009-10 for 5 years and again from 22nd August to January 2006. His 2 years with Wallen Bartram, his 2 years effort resulted in getting the status of Institute of National Importance in March. And that was by an act of parliament in September 2012. That's a real achievement. He is a member of teaching faculty in the Department of Neurology for more than 34 years. Now, in Gurdaga, ask Vasa, I never get that. And then they know that. Actually, it's so difficult to say. 34 years, at he was. And as professor of neurology for 16 years, he is currently working as senior professor of neurology. After completing DM Neurology from Nimans in 1981, was selected as a faculty member in the Department of Neurology in 1982. At Nimans, he was selected as an International Neuroscience Fellow at NIMS National Institute of Health, Bethesda, USA for 1 year. This was sponsored by WHO, 4RP, NIA, subsequently for a visiting associate for 3 more months at NIA, USA. He this time worked in the field of neuroepidemiology and epilepsy. The epilepsy, you know, now we're very familiar, that was 5 years from here. I think from 60. Not that, he's going to go to 50%. I'm not going to go to the corner of my office. But I'll allow him to go to the corner of my office. Such a brilliant speaker, you know. For same tradition, no? Same brilliance, his student is continuing. No? Awarded senior visiting fellowship at Raymond Medicine's group at Institute of Neurology, Queen's Square, London, UK for 6 months, year number 9900. Awarded honorary professor, University of Liverpool, UK, and then epilepsy, electroencephalography, and evoked potentials, neuroepidemiology, and neuroinfections, including neuroARDS, they're all fields of interest for him. And large number of awards, Ambassador for Epilepsy, Ambassador for Epilepsy Award, 2017, for International League of Epilepsy and International Bureau of Epilepsy, will be receiving during the 32nd International Epilepsy Congress in Barcelona, 2017, will be receiving number 20, 2017. Awarded, in fact, here, currently for important, in the Eastern Award, a current Santosh Prasadhyaksha. Awarded Sir Vishwesha Senior Science State Award for the year 2016 for lifetime contribution for the development of science and technology in China. Received prestigious Karnataka Rajyotsava, a state award in recognition of the contribution state in the field of medicine 2014. Vasanthi Devi Amichan, ICMR Award for Biomedical Scientist 2013. Asia Oceanian Outstanding Achievement Award in Epilepsy from CAOA International League Against Epilepsy at Melbourne, Australia. Sir Sri Raman Yang Scientist Award by Karnataka State Government for Research in Epilepsy in 1998. Today, I'm saying for me, all level there, a young stage come out there are almost 7 to 8 speakers. Then they were like, you know, the PA speakers on a type of person with whom they like interaction. ICMR award for neurology research and epilepsy. Young stage cover, under one. At International Epilepsy Congress, Oslo, Norway. Sir J.C. Board Award for contribution in the field of neurology, 2012. National level A. President, Indian Academy of Neurology. President, Indian Epilepsy Society. President, Karnataka Neuroscience Academy. We have done it for 2 years. International Chairman, IPA, Southeastern Asian Regional Executive Board, member ILAE Genetics Commission. Of course, large number of papers, 270 papers, including 51 book chapters, 7 monographs, including 2 on neuroepidemiology, 1 on epilepsy, and 1 in ethics in neurosciences. Now, the last speakers in Yukon of the it is so fun. In fact, the whole idea of this exam is to bring the developments in science and also the latest development. The speaker, Wayne Narethe, who 15 years back gave a lecture on social media, social networking. Facebook built it then. It was not there. So we have said, Facebook built it. Later, he gave it on market designs and game theory. And that got a gold prize for some other person, you know. Somebody won the gold prize in economics to identify two people. It was so difficult in the world. New technology. Monday, blockchain analysis model. That technology, I think, almost going to overtake all social media, all data, and big data analytics, artificial intelligence, or robotics, everything. The whole idea is, in the science form, to bring the latest developments in science and technology. And then, now you will be talking. You are traveling in metro light now. I don't know how many they are far like this, but still it's a good one. And if you want to know Bangalore Metro, past, what are the difficulties? Present, what are the things we are engaging? Future, how it has to be changed? That is given by Mr. P.S. Sudhir Chandra, former project director, Strike in Hospital, form, Bangalore Metro Corporation Limited, former driver board. Tumba Santosh Agarwal, he was a student from P.S. Sudhir Chandra. So, hello, I'm a director. You went to the NRK Pune. Get it? Then, 1807, Dr. K.S. is a very top neurologist, scientist, director, free research for tissue engineering, to speak on basic research, changing the pattern of clinical practice. You may put it up, very good doctors are there, nobody are. Very good research people are there. Conversation is difficult. And one such conversation, Dr. K.S. is there. And the entire top neurologist, in Mundi Kirtane, or 1 hour free clinic for that.
My privilege and an honor to be here this evening. I have chosen a topic today of epilepsy and law. You may be wondering, why, what is this special? Mr. Damodar Rao is here from Indian Epilepsy Association. He has asked me, what is this new subject you have taken this time? Yes, this is a new subject, we know. But there is certain special features. That's why I have taken this. 2017 has been a remarkable year already. We have just passed 6 months. And in these 6 months, there are a number of laws that have come out. I'm sure all of you are aware of GST. And we talk about GST. But what is more important is there is laws regarding physical disability. Disability law has been passed in the government, which was pending for a very, very long time. Motor Vehicle Act amendment has been passed during this period, which has a lot of relevance to the subject which I have chosen to do. That is epilepsy. And that is the reason I thought in 2017 I should talk on epilepsy and law. What is this epilepsy? Everybody knows now. Epileptic seizure is the manifestation of an abnormal electrical activity. It is an abnormal activity. You all know about the short circuit when a current passes. And whenever there is a short circuit, you get a shock. Same way, when there is a current in the brain, when it becomes abnormal, for various reasons, that produces epilepsy. That is the simplest way one can explain. And this epilepsy word has been used in a different way. Like fit, we all use the word fit. We all use the word convulsion. We all use the word seizure. But epilepsy, when we say, that means it has to be regular. That means a person should have more than one attack. Only when it is more than one attack, we use the word epilepsy. It could be active or it could be remote. That means in once in a lifetime, a patient may have a seizure. No man or woman, however rich or poor, whether coming from the rural or urban area, can exempt from this. Anybody can be affected. We have a lot of instances of famous scientists, famous astronomers, various people like Alexander the Great. Everybody has suffered from epilepsy. So that is epilepsy, which is very, very important. From birth till death, anybody can suffer from epilepsy. We are worried about this. The reason for that is the magnitude. In magnitude, there are about 50 million people suffering from epilepsy in the whole world, of which 30 million are in only developing countries. And we contribute 8 million people from this country, which is there in urban as well as in the rural area. And a lot of epidemiological studies have been done to show that how common is this epilepsy. Professor A. Ramra was mentioning about Dr. Mani. Dr. Mani is known as father of Indian epileptology. And I was fortunate to be his student. And then he did a lot of survey in Elandur. I'm sure you must have heard about the Elandur and Hilly tribal area. And I myself did a study in Bangalore urban rural epidemiological study in short form known as BURG, B-U-R-G. And we did this study from different places, from Gaurimittu, from Bangalore, Elandur, and we have looked at how common is this, and we all are aware now there is about 8 per 1,000 population suffer from epilepsy. You may wonder, 8 per 1,000, such a small number, 8 per 1,000 in this country of 1.2 billion, you can calculate what will be the problem what we are facing. But most important is not that. What I want you to observe is the last part of it. This is the treatment gap. What do you mean by treatment gap? The treatment gap is gap in the treatment. These people are not taking the treatment. How often? 40 to 75% of them are not taking the treatment. I have always said, even in Nimhans we have located, just behind is Wilson Garden. The people from Wilson Garden are not taking the treatment. What can we do? This is the problem we are facing. The treatment gap is very, very high. What I am saying is, you must understand the social ethos behind this. And that is the problem we face in this disease. And the treatment gap is because of lack of diagnosis, and then we have reluctance. So you can say that the reluctance is to accept the diagnosis. I always quote this, my favorite joke. I go to a hotel, I will say that, sir, now we have coffee, some sugar, kami hai problem. ನನಗೆ ಡಯಾಬಿಟೀಸ್ ಇದೆ. ಇನ್ನೊಬ್ಬ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ನನಗೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಉಪ್ಪು ಕಮ್ಮಿ ಆಗ್ಬಿಡಿ, ನನಗೆ ಹೈಪರ್ ಟೆನ್ಷನ್ ಇದೆ. ಯಾರಾದರೂ ನನಗೆ ಎಪಿಲೆಪ್ಸಿ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಯಾರಾದ್ರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ? ಯಾರು ಹೇಳಲ್ಲ. ಯಾಕೆ? ವೈ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್? ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್? ದಿ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಈಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಸ್ಟಿಗ್ಮಾ. ಐ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಸೇ ಎಪಿಲೆಪ್ಸಿ ಇಸ್ ಬೆಟರ್ ಡಿಸೀಸ್ ಟು ಹ್ಯಾವ್. ದ ರೀಸನ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇನ್ ಎಪಿಲೆಪ್ಸಿ ನೋ ಅದರ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಫೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್. ಇನ್ ಹೈಪರ್ ಟೆನ್ಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡಯಾಬಿಟೀಸ್ you have liver, you have heart, you have brain, you have eyes, you have kidney, everything gets affected. On the other hand, here is a disease which nothing else gets affected. Which is a better disease? Epilepsy is a better disease. If God comes to you and asks which disease do you like to have, I think you should ask for epilepsy rather than diabetes or blood pressure. That is what I always say. But the problem is different. The problem is the social awareness. Social problems are many, much, much more in this. That is the problem one need to worry about. That is reluctance to accept the diagnosis and social prejudice against the modern medicines. And that is the problem. The people don't want to take the treatment. That is the problem. But there are many conditions, I'm not going into the details, but there are conditions which can mimic like epilepsy. And that would be mistaken, like syncope, which is nothing but fainting. We all faint. Yes. I'm sure I remember in our own school days when we are standing in the prayer hall, suddenly one fellow will drop, after that another fellow will drop in a hot summer days. That happens because that is a syncope. That syncope is fainting. But that is not epilepsy. Similarly, we have many sleep disorders which mimics that epilepsy, and there are many conditions like low blood sugar which can cause problems. That is not epilepsy. But everything people consider as epilepsy. Other day, my own relative went to the bathroom and then suddenly tapped on the door. She was about 75 years old. What has happened? Nobody knew. Suddenly she has fallen down in the early morning at 7 o'clock. And when she went to a restroom, this is very, very common. That is not epilepsy. That is due to fainting. The pressure to the brain comes down and leads to loss of blood supply, resulting in epilepsy. So we need confirmation. We confirm epilepsy from history, from an eyewitness account, and now we confirm epilepsy by mobile phone. Even mobile phone which is there with all of you, we make a proper diagnosis with this mobile phone. You may be wondering how. We always ask the patient to record that in a mobile phone, whatever they see, and bring it to us, so that we will be able to analyze that. Mobile phone is one important investigation now to look at this diagnosis. But in the lab we do EEG. What causes epilepsy? Everybody asks a million-dollar question. So we have a very, very famous quotation. The quotation was in way back in 1887. Professor Gower said that every fit may be said to be in part the result of those that have preceded it, the cause of those which follow it. What a beautiful statement. That is epilepsy. So I don't know what is the cause. That is why we use the word idiopathic. We use the word, beautiful word, idiopathic. If you ask me a question, what is idiopathic mean? If you open a dictionary, the important, simple thing is, cause I do not know. The cause I do not know is the cause for epilepsy. That is the problem. So we don't say we don't know the cause. We use the word idiopathic, sophisticated word, to say that I don't know. That is the problem. So the commonest cause we still do not know, and this is the quotation. But there are many causes, genetic causes, acquired causes, congenital causes, which are there. This is one of the commonest causes, and that is due to tapeworm infestation. Tapeworm is one of the commonest causes. I always say, why do you get epilepsy? You are all eating food, very, very tasty panipuri. I still remember in my college days, in front of the National College, there is one panipuri fellow who was extremely popular, and all of us used to go and eat. And that is one of the causes for epilepsy. The problem is the hygienic condition is so bad, the water is so bad, that produces cysticercosis, a tapeworm infection in the brain, and that produces the commonest cause for epilepsy in young individuals. Then there are certain abnormalities, and this abnormality may be there since birth, and that causes the commonest cause for epilepsy. There are some malformations in the brain which causes epilepsy. But what is important is, very important, we can treat epilepsy. There are number of drugs are available. You can see here that This whole yellow color has come from 1980 onwards. From 1840 to 1980, only this many drugs were there. Now we have more than 25 drugs available. Thanks to the research in the field of epilepsy, we have plenty of drugs available. We can treat most of these causes of epilepsy. So we now divide epilepsy into two groups. One is 75% of the epilepsy can be easily be treated with or without anti-epileptic drugs. 20 to 25% seizure, people continue to get seizures in spite of the drugs. And there are also very, very interesting things. Spontaneous remission, even without treatment, the patient will be all right. I'm sure all of you maybe know, you can ask your elders in your family, they say, why all these people take drugs? There is no need for drugs. We never have taken any drug. My child also had seizures. Everything was recovered. So what is known as spontaneous remission? And there are spontaneous remission. Even in India, when Dr. Mani was doing a study in Elendur, he showed that in Elendur itself, so many people have not taken the treatment and they are doing very well. That is called spontaneous remission. So spontaneous remission also can occur in some of the conditions, but never wait for that. Don't wait that there will be a spontaneous remission. It is like that a good day will come and then don't do any work. I say that a good day will come. Good day will come when you want to work hard. When you work hard, good day will come. That is how it is. But we don't take that as spontaneous remission. But all these things are good aspects. We have drugs, there is spontaneous remission, everything is there. Then what is the problem? They can go to school. A person with epilepsy is totally normal in between the time. These are all only for short time. 1 minute, 2 minutes. 1 minute is a too long a period when a person gets an attack. But in between the attack, the person is perfectly normal. Then they can go to the school. Yes, absolutely they can go to school. They can take employment. They can drive. They can travel. They can enjoy music. They can take any food. They can take any fruits. They can become pregnant. They can participate in sports. They can marry. They can use computer. They can use television. Everything is possible. Then, with so much of good news of epilepsy, what is the problem? You may be wondering, all these things are good. The problem is not with the patient. The problem is with the society. That is the problem we are facing. The problem, major problem is in the society, how we look after these people with epilepsy. That is the sorrow state of affairs. That is why I gave the example of diabetes and hypertension, and how people proudly say that I am a diabetic, I am a hypertensive. Nobody wants to say that I am an epileptic. And that is the problem we are facing in the society with a lot of stigma. And there are a lot of ground realities we need to understand. That is what I am coming to the problem. In the past, the knowledge was that epilepsy is possessed by devils, epilepsy is a mental illness, epilepsy, no drugs are available, epilepsy is hereditary. But what we now know is attitude and practice. Even now, witchcraft has been done. Cannot be cured, people say, cannot be cured, cannot marry, and families are ostracized. You all know that there are families with epilepsy. Nobody goes there. Nobody even now wants to get a girl from that family to get married. So this is the problem we are facing. It is just like any other disorder, but still they have a problem. What is the present knowledge? The present knowledge says it is a brain disorder. It is also a disorder, it is from the brain. 80% can be controlled well with the drugs. 80%, that is very important. Hereditary is only about 4%, which is a very, very small number. And I'm sure everyone will ask you, what is the hereditary aspect of epilepsy? It is only 4%. Rather than saying 4%, I say 96% is not genetics. That is a better way of saying. If I say it is like a bata, 99. If they say 99, you call it bad. If you say one completely, then they will say it is too costly. If they say 22 rupees, 99 paisa, it looks better. If they say 23 rupees, it has become more. That is the problem. That is our mental makeup. In the same way, instead of saying it is a 4% genetics hereditary, I say 96% of the time, there is no genetics, there is no hereditary in epilepsy. 2 to 5 years treatment is only required, not lifelong treatment, as we see in case of diabetes and hypertension. But what is attitude again? Attitude is mental illness. It cannot be treated for a long time, people think. and it is hereditary. PW means we always now don't use the word epileptics. We always say people, person with epilepsy or people living with epilepsy. And they are not normal, so they cannot marry, they cannot have any education. That is the problem. What is the societal attitude? The attitude for the PWE is with education, employment, marriage, children, sports, travel, and ultimately, it is a self-esteem. Self-esteem is the problem. A person with epilepsy, you talk to him, they feel that they are not confident. They feel that their self-esteem is lost in the society. That is because we made them, our society has made them to feel that way. So what can be done? There are some laws. We always look for the law. And there are laws with epilepsy in marriage, epilepsy in driving, epilepsy in disability act, and anti-discrimination law. So we will look at how does the law looks at epilepsy. First and foremost thing, there was earlier, epilepsy was equated to insanity. Can you believe that? Epilepsy was equated to insanity. You all know what is insanity. Insanity is a mental illness. So epilepsy was considered as a mental illness. And so, according to the law, the people can get divorced because if the person had an epilepsy. And this was the problem for ages and ages. And our Indian Epilepsy Association Bangalore chapter, headed by Dr. K.S. Mani, and all of us worked very hard to repeal that law. The law has to be changed. And Mani used to say the jokes after jokes. And his standard joke, I can tell you, that he wrote a letter to the first Prime Minister at that time. I don't name who is that person. And as soon as he wrote a letter, that Prime Minister was changed. And after 6 months, he said that he will write another letter. And that letter, immediately that Prime Minister was changed. Then it happened that the third time he wrote, and the third Prime Minister also was changed. Then he used to ask, do you want the next Prime Minister to be changed? I will do this. That is my power. That means if I write a letter regarding epilepsy and marriage, that will never come up. And that the Prime Minister will be all changed. And I'm sure you must have guessed what was that period, when was that period. Every 6 months there was a new Prime Minister there in our country. And that was the time this all happened. And we struggled and struggled very hard. At the end of it, when it went up to the Supreme Court to change this law was to be changed. It was not correct law, and it cannot be equated to insanity. Then at that time, the parliamentarian headed by the present president of India, so took up and said that, no, we should not fight it out for such a wonderful cause. We will withdraw this, and we will pass this law. And the law was passed in 1992. And the law was passed, but what is the problem? 1999, we passed this law. Anything has changed? Nothing has changed. What is the problem? The problem is not the law, the problem is with us again, society. Society doesn't accept. Can you force anybody? You can't force anybody to marry. The law can say that you cannot take a divorce on them. But what is it that they won't take the divorce, they leave apart. That's all. What is the point? The point we have not achieved is because it is not the law which is making the person, it is what we have to practice, the attitude, which is extremely important. And it is, if you see, India was not lagging behind. It was in 2000 or 1999, we have repealed the law about epilepsy and marriage. That means any person with epilepsy can marry and lead a normal life. That is what the law says now. But it was repealed in UK in 1970, and it is repealed in USA in 1980. So this is as recent as 70 and 80s, and we repealed in 1999. So we are also in line with them, and people with epilepsy can marry and can lead a normal life like anybody else, and they don't get divorced if they go to the court and fight for them. They will not be able to get that. Now let us move on to important aspect. Should person with epilepsy be allowed to drive vehicle? You may be shocked. What is this? What am I talking? But the answer lies below. Yes, of course. Say, my guru, Dr. H.V. Srinivas. H.V. Srinivas was my teacher also. He's a senior consultant in neurology now. And he has taken the mantle of Dr. Mani, just like our Ramarao takes the mantle of Hachar. is exactly the same way, and he is leading the epilepsy in our state of Karnataka, and we all work together. So what he says is, of course, a person with epilepsy can drive. What is the problem? The problem is, we all know epilepsy can occur at any time. And imagine, I am on the seat, driver's seat, and I get an attack. What will happen to me? Completely gone. Control is gone totally. And I will hit anybody on the road. Do I have a license to do that? That is the question all of you will ask. And I still remember, I think I have not got that paper photo cutting. There was an accident which has happened in front of Vijaya College in the southern area. There was a person who was driving a BTS bus, and the BTS bus driver had epilepsy. And he has not revealed it to the people, that means to his employer, and he was driving. And when he was driving in front of Vijaya College, he suddenly started getting a seizure. Suddenly started getting a seizure, and he became unconscious. What will happen to his steering wheel? Steering wheel is out of control. And out of control means it is like a brakeless vehicle. You know what will happen to the brakeless vehicle. And everybody started running from there because it was a havoc there. And there were a lot of scooters on the other side of the footpath. He hit against the scooter and then it stopped. But imagine 1 minute that you are in that bus. How do you feel? You are almost, your life is in your hand. It is gone. That is because of the driver who had a seizure. So that means, what am I saying? Can epilepsy person drive? Is the question, which is goes to a law now. And we will see what has happened to that. In India, it is not still a problem. Driving license, we still do not have much problem. And it is not a necessity. I can still leave. We have a metro now, we have a BTS buses, so we can travel. But in a Western country, I'm sure many of you have gone abroad and have seen, if you don't have a driving license, it is almost like you are a useless person in that country. You cannot do anything. Absolutely you are tied. You cannot do anything without a driving license. So if the driving license is taken away, that means it is equal to you are putting in the jail. It is almost like that. That is the reason. It is a luxury in most part of India, but it is all slowly changing. It is a basic necessity in the West and for city dwellers. But what is important? Denial of driving. If I don't give you driving license, what does it happen? That means it reduces employment opportunity. It limits your socialization. Naturally, you are not free. Then most important, again, it reduces your self-esteem. My self-esteem goes down. That is the problem you face as a driver. But what has happened is that if I say your epilepsy can be controlled, what is the problem then? If I am able to control your epilepsy, why should I not be allowed to drive? That is the question a person with epilepsy will ask me. The first question they ask, sir, can I drive? And he is having a helmet in his hand. And he will be coming there, sitting in front of me, asking me a question. Sir, can I drive? What are you doing now? Sir, I drove. That is the reason you are asking me now. That is the point which I always ask them. Reverse way, can he drive? Already, in the most of the Western countries, there are many decisions which are being taken. But unfortunately, in India, still we have not taken any decision regarding. The reason for that is, they are excluded from driving privileges. Because of why? Fear of accident, which I gave you listed it. Adherence and compliance problem. Our problems are different. They don't take the drugs, they don't take the medication, and that leads to the problem. And then doctors don't report. Any doctor will report against the patient. I always tell them, I tell them that if you start driving now, I have to inform the police. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult for you, especially public vehicle. I'm talking about public vehicle, not for the ordinary day-to-day car or your own bicycle or the scooter. Lack of representation, there are problems. Because these people are not there in the association which makes the decision. And often it is asked by the doctors, legal experts, RTOs, how the seizure can occur. You have seen these pictures. You have seen these pictures which has occurred, resulted in a patient having a seizure while driving. Can I allow that? Is the question. But I want you to observe this. What is the chances? Extremely remote possibility. It is 0.03%. It is almost like that when I am in this building, there is a chance that the building can collapse and we can have an earthquake. Yes, it can happen. Can I take and wait for that? And can I say that I will not enter in the road? I will not walk in the road because an accident can happen? You cannot. You have to take certain risks, and the risk is 0.03%. That is important. Compared to that, there are many causes for road accidents. What are the other causes which we are not talking about? We talk about only the epilepsy and try to blame them. But the most important cause is overspeeding, drunken driving, distraction to driving. Now the most common distraction is mobile phone. You will be having a mobile phone and then driving. That is the major problem. Then red light jumping, avoiding using helmet and seat belts. And these are all the causes for more often accident than epilepsy. Let us look at the literature. In USA, there are about 40,000 per year accidents. And when we look at the cause for the accident, the commonest cause, what we see is 30% is alcohol related. 30% is alcohol related, which can be easily be prevented. Very, very simple. Person with alcohol or drunken driving should never be permitted. That is the most important one. And what is epilepsy related? 0.2%. What we are making noise? They are making noise for 0.2%, and we have left 30%, which is due to alcohol related. Which one should you tackle first? You must tackle the alcohol, not the 0.2% which is causing the problem. But there are other causes. Hearing impairment, visual impairment, Parkinson's disease, Meniere's disease, ischemic heart disease. All these things are all the problem for a person when he wants to drive. And that is very, very important. Rather than epilepsy. In India, you see the number, we have 150,000 to 200,000 accidents per year. 40% are due to trucks and two-wheelers. Two extremes. We have 40% due to trucks and 2% is being two-wheelers. In between is not much. But what we are worried is about epilepsy in this group of people. So what can be done? What is the important message here? 93% seizure reduction if you control the epilepsy seizure, and if the person has no seizure in 1 year, they can try. There is risk, it comes down drastically. And in the last 6 months, if a person has no seizure, 85% risk reduction is there. That means what? If a person is seizure free for the last 6 months, the last 1 year, they can try. Absolutely, there is no problem at all. Then why are we banning this? And what is happening is the problem with driving. So it all depends upon what type of seizure you have, what is the frequency of the attack, whether you are taking drugs properly, that means anti-epileptic drug, and whether you are driving most of the time, and what is your lifestyle in general. These are the important factors which decide about it. So the law has taken a different way, and now they have come out in different countries. Here is the driving permitted for LMV. You know what is LMV? Light motor vehicles. So light motor vehicles are almost all the vehicles which we do for day-to-day practice. And when a light motor vehicle we have, and if a person has seizure, if they are free from seizure, in USA between 3 months to 18 months, depends upon different states. Because in USA there are 50 states, and each state has got its own law. That is the problem. And here, we are a country with uniform law, so we are far better than USA. That is what is it. Yes. So, in USA, they have 3 months to 18 months if a person is seizure-free, then they can drive. In UK, Europe, New Zealand, 12 months. In Canada, 6 months. Korea, Malaysia, Australia, Japan, 24 months. They have their own. So, what about the heavy vehicle? Heavy vehicle means your trucks or even buses and other things. Most of the countries, that cannot be done. A person who is having an epilepsy cannot drive. I go one step further. What about pilots? Air pilots. They can never. And they are subjected to stress tests. And we are all being asked to report on them. And I still have a very, very interesting case which came to me. The first lady pilot of this country. The first lady pilot wanted to make a history that she wanted to be now used. Whenever you go to any aircraft, you will be hearing all ladies' names are there. There are plenty of lady pilots. But what was important was the first lady pilot. When she wanted to become a first lady pilot in this country, she was subjected to various tests. And what happened? One of the tests in the ECG, EEG, picked up certain abnormality. When it picked up abnormality, they are never allowed. They are never allowed to become a pilot. But she was desperate that she wanted to prove a point, a lady can become a pilot. And that's why she went from pillar to pillar, and she also came to NIMHANS. And we also did the studies on her, and continuous studies, overnight sleeplessness, and then we put her into a lot of stress and strain to see the abnormality whether there were abnormalities. Why I'm asking this question is, a person with epilepsy has to come out openly that I have seizures. If they don't say I have seizures, it is very difficult to prove the point. That is the problem. But this lady had an EEG abnormality, which shows that she must have had seizure sometime, or even if she doesn't have a seizure, she has electrical abnormality. What does that electrical abnormality mean? You are in a stressful situation. You are on an aircraft at a height of about 36,000 feet. Then suddenly you have to apply something. You cannot because you get a seizure. Imagine what can happen. That is the problem. So any person with any abnormality in a seizure, they can never become a pilot in their life, and she was not allowed to become a pilot. That was a sad state, but it is a fact. And even today, it happens if a person has a seizure or an epileptic abnormality, they can never become a pilot. But what about heavy vehicles? Most of the countries have banned that. Belgium, Portugal, Ireland. But in developed countries like New Zealand, Canada, Germany, and Sweden, if a person is 5 years free, they can drive. And in UK, Europe, USA, Switzerland, 10 years they should be free. I will come to India, you are all 18. Here is the list. Those who have never had a seizure are prohibited from driving. What is this law? That means, if I had one attack of seizure, I can never drive according to the law. We can never drive, whether it is a moped, or whether it is a scooter, or whether it is a motorbike, or whether it is a car, or whether it is a bus, or a truck. I can never drive. So there are countries like that, including China. So we are not lagging behind. So China and we are competing together for that. And here also we are competing that ever had a seizure, we can never have a driving license. This is a proof here. I'm sure many of you, today's paper say, in India, 85% of the people are getting license without even having a test. I think you saw the headline today. And I don't know how many of you had a test and taken the license, or you are taking license because 85% mean some of you must have taken license without going for a test. So what is the reason? Why I'm asking you that question is, here is a form. This is the form we are all supposed to fill up when we want to take a license. And what does that say? I have marked it here. Declaration. What is the declaration? Do you suffer from epilepsy or from sudden attack of loss of consciousness or giddiness from any cause? Did you not have any giddiness anytime? Anybody who had no giddiness in your lifetime, please raise your hand. I don't think anybody can. You didn't have giddiness, sir?
Yes, sir.
Never? I think you must be recorded. I can say that. Because giddiness is such a common given. All of a sudden, I can boldly say that I have giddiness. So when there is a giddiness, it's such a common thing. You see this ridiculous statement. Don't put me anywhere. I hope there is no RTOs or police personnel here. Otherwise, I will be behind bars. So please see, this is the form which we are all signing today. Do you suffer from epilepsy or from sudden attacks of loss of consciousness or giddiness from any cause? That also is there. And you say yes, you will not get a license. That is the problem. And then the doctor who certifies you, you have to get a doctor's this was certificate. And in that certificate, he also has to say one of the important things is the question number 7A. Is the applicant, to the best of your judgment, subject to epilepsy, vertigo, or any mental ailment likely to affect his driving efficiency? what will I say? If you say yes, what will happen? You will never get a license. That is the problem. So here also, a doctor also has to be responsible, and a patient also has to say, this is our form, which we all fill up even today. I'm telling you even today. This is the form which we need to fill up. And we are all filling it up. And I'm sure how many of you are people with epilepsy or giddiness, and how many of you have said yes. I'm sure 100% of people say no. So, this is the situation we are in, according to the law. So, when you think about marriage and epilepsy, it took 12 years of struggle. Three prime ministers, I'll tell you again, three prime ministers for 12 years, and a hard work of Indian Epilepsy Association to get this Hindu Marriage Act amended. And finally, we succeeded by public interest litigation, not by any other, BIA, and in the Supreme Court. Now again we have said, rather than working for 12 years, let us start public interest litigation itself. That is the best way of approaching the problem. And IEA started the ball rolling by addressing the letters to the Ministry of Surface Transport, Government of India, with several reminders sent so far to amend this law. And what we have, 2016, the law was taken up, and there was a bill which is called Motor Vehicle Amendment Act of 2017, which was passed in April. We are in July. And what is the law says now? They are all very happy. They have changed on concentrating on radical reform in transport sector that will usher in multifold hike in the fine, traffic violations, compensation of 5 lakh for grave injury, check the bogus licenses and vehicle theft. And what about epilepsy? Nobody bothered. That is, we are talking about 2017 April. Still we do not have. Unfortunate situation we are in. That means all our effort has gone to futile exercise. We are still do not have an amendment to Motor Vehicle Act where the law can be repealed. What is happening now, ground reality, is that what is happening? Everybody is driving. Merrily they are driving. So everybody with epilepsy, whether he is a heavy vehicle or light vehicle, everybody is driving. Large proportion to the patient do not comply with the driving restrictions. Many patients continue driving despite having seizures, do not report to the driving authority. So this occurs in many countries. India is also no exception. Only thing is, we can pat our back that we are not the only country in the world. There are many other countries. We are also poor. That is the unfortunate situation we are in with reference to law. So Indian law says, if you ever had, you can never drive. That is the problem. So what do we advise our patients? So we need to advise. We need to advise our patient. We say, if a person has a seizure-free period for 1 year with a good compliance of the anti-epileptic drug, they can drive light motor vehicles. That means you can drive scooter, but of course without the helmet is not a thing. You have to wear the helmet and you have to wear the seat belt. Those are all important, essential things. And after withdrawal APD, if a person is anti-epileptic drug is withdrawn, 3 to 6 months later, they can. And if the person has only one attack of seizure, it is not epilepsy, they can drive after 6 months. This is what we follow now, and we advise all our patients in other country at least to follow this. But if somebody says, who has given you a right, we don't have a right. I don't have a right to describe all these things, but we have suggested this. So the conclusions regarding epilepsy driving, persons with epilepsy should be allowed to drive with certain specifications. That is important. And not to drive the heavy vehicles. Truck driver, 40% of accidents are due to truck driver. So please avoid that. That is very important. And seizure-free period of 1 year is enough. Motor Vehicle Act in India requires to be amended. So when will I wait for the next amendment? I don't know. We have just passed in April and we have missed the bus. So imagine what is our life now. Physicians should provide medical information. Driving license authorities should determine the eligibility of that before saying, and not that form which we fill every day. Then we will go on to education, employment and insurance are a major problem. We have problems with education. There are many schools they don't take. the person having epilepsy into their school. What is the reason? There is no reason at all. They think that it spreads from one child to another child. Such teachers we have. It is so unfortunate that they don't allow the children with epilepsy to come to the school. What about employment? The employee, especially the private government, private employers, if one seizure occurs in front of them, that is the end of his career. So I have seen many, many people, there is no employment guarantee, and these people suffer just because they get one attack which lasts for 30 seconds, maybe once in how many years, you know. There are people who get once in 6 months, there are people who get once in a year, once in 2 years, and that law has not taken care of them. And that is the reason we are having a problem with employment and epilepsy, education and epilepsy, and insurance. Of course, we can never hope there are nobody from the insurance company here. Insurance companies are there to make money, not to give money. They never give money. They give money to only 1% of the people. They collect 99% of the people's money. And that is what our insurance are. And what happens? Any chronic disorder, they don't accept. So they don't want any chronic disorder. They want only young people who are in hale and healthy to have insurance so that they will not have any risk. The moment you cross 50 years, your insurance premium will go up. The moment you cross 60, it will go up further. And 70, of course, they may not even take it off. That is the level we are in insurance, especially for people with epilepsy. So beautiful quotation. George Burden, I gave an oration in his name, first Secretary General of the Indian International Bureau for Epilepsy, said, "Do not give a person a job because he has epilepsy. Do not deny him a job because he has epilepsy." What a beautiful quotation. So that is what is the employment status for a person with epilepsy. You must give them, and they are no way different from other countries. And this is the famous quotation of George Burden. What about the Disability Act? There is a disability, you know that. And the people talk about disability. You all know about physical disability, visual disability, you know about hearing disability. What does the law say? The law in USA, which is Americans with Disability Act, which has been passed in 1990, prohibits description in discrimination in employment against people with epilepsy who are otherwise qualified, including private enterprises. See how progressive it is. And includes patients with epilepsy who are epilepsy and are free from seizures. That is the progressive nation. See, we can have a GDP, 10% GDP we can reach. We can reach income status very high level. We are never developed unless we have certain laws against this discrimination. These are very, very important. And one of the conditions for epilepsy, Disability Act is extremely important. We are marching. We are slow in every respect. And here also we are slowly marching. We are moving forward. We will see what does Indian law says. But this is all done even in US, not very, very, very early. They have done on September 25, 2008. President Bush signed the ADA Amendments Act into law on that day in a private ceremony. And this act will secure protections against workplace discrimination for Americans with disability. And this bill marks a historic move towards securing the promise of the original Americans with Disabilities Act signed into law by President H.W. Bush, his father, in 1990. They have amended in 2008 the American Disability Law. Okay? In UK, it makes it illegal to discriminate against disabled people in UK. You cannot discriminate. Just because a person is disabled, you cannot take. I can give a classic example. I have a student who is a psychiatrist in our own institute. He's blind. He's blind totally. Can you imagine? A person can be blind and become a psychiatrist? Of course he can become. He can become, and he is a wonderful student. And he does all the things possible, has an excellent knowledge. So he is now becoming, actually he has passed out just now. He is a psychiatrist, he passed his MD. So it is possible. a person, and you have all heard about IAS and a blind people.
Yes, yes.
In the paper, controversy went on for a very long time, and the court has to intervene, and then they can become. When blind people can become, what is wrong with people with epilepsy to have any employment? I don't see any reason at all. They should be, except that heavy vehicle driver. Yes, you cannot. Patient with epilepsy, seizures totally controlled, past history of epilepsy, it is illegal if you discriminate them. What does the government of India now say? We saw about UK, we saw about USA. Government of India constitution, fundamental right, in Article 14 says, equality before the law and equal protection of the law for every individual. Equality of opportunities in matter of public employment. That's what we all proudly say that. And there is no comprehensive anti-discrimination. That is the problem we don't have. But what is the problem here in epilepsy? The problem is only with 20% of the people, not with every epilepsy patient. 20 to 25% people are disabled because they have taken a lot of drugs for maintenance, for the compliance, for the frequent attacks. And that group should be included with Disability Act of 1995. And in 1995, India has provided Persons with Disability Act or PWD. We say education, employment, and we also say 3% of the jobs in government and semi-government organization could be reserved for disabled people. Disability means what? Low vision, blindness, leprosy, mental retardation, locomotor disability. Where is epilepsy? Nowhere. Epilepsy was not there in 1995 Act. But fortunately, we are very, very fortunate and we are very happy. But we are unhappy to some extent. We are never be satisfied people. That is one thing. 2017 April, a law has been passed. And this was 2016 bill. Lok Sabha passed, that is 16 December 2016. At 1828, we have the time here also. The Persons with Disability Bill, Right of Persons with Disability Bill 2016, the bill will replace the existing PWD Act of 1995, which I just now gave, which was enacted 21 years ago. It took 21 years to change our law. And then, the Rajya Sabha has already passed the bill, so the salient features of the bill, disability has been defined based on evolving and dynamic concept. That is very, very important, and types of disabilities have been increased. I'm sure you must have read in the newspaper the big advertisements. And the advertisements say disability from 7 to 21, and central government will have the power to add more types of disability. And the 21 disabilities are given below, which includes blindness, low vision, leprosy, hearing impairment, locomotor disability, dwarfism, intellectual disability, mental illness, autism spectrum disorder, cerebral palsy, muscular dystrophy, chronic neurological condition, specific learning disability, multiple sclerosis, speech and language disability, thalassemia, hemophilia, sickle cell disease, multiple disabilities including deafblindness, acid attack victims, then Parkinson's disease. There is epilepsy. Not there. Not there. But I am unhappy about that. But one thing we have covered. The item number 12 says chronic neurological condition, which is a broad category. Under this broad category, we can include epilepsy. So that means a person with disability, about 20% of the people who are taking multiple drugs, who have a refractory type of epilepsy, can be covered under chronic neurological condition. And they have, I'm very happy because multiple neurological disorders have been included in the new law which has been passed as late as in February of 2017. And there they are covered, and these people will get benefit in various aspects. So we have moved. Though after 21 years, we have moved slowly but steadily. Still we do not have comprehensive discriminatory law. We still do not have driving laws. We still do not have employment opportunities fully, though it has been risen from 3% to 5% now. But we are still a long way to go. That is why we are still a developing country. We are less industrialized country. We are now considered as a learning country. We are not a developing country. We are learning country. What is important is we are still developing. And we require a lot of development to occur. And development is not only in the form of monetary thing or GDP. it is development in a holistic way, where it includes the care of people with disability is essential. One of the things I'm sure National College must have adopted, that all the buildings should have disabled friendly now.
Yes.
That is taken in every level, and buses are becoming disabled friendly, the trains are becoming disabled friendly, but still we have a long way to go regarding discriminatory law, reservation for them, and also for the employment opportunities. And this is the problem which we face in epilepsy. So my teacher, Dr. K.S. Mani, I quote, what is important is a disease that affects at that time 40 million people, yet 3/4 are untreated. That is what we are in. Early diagnosis and proper management, if you do, could effectively control 3/4 of them. That is the best part of it. We can control, we can do wonderful things, provided they take the treatment. Unfortunately, that is not there. And that is what we are in. And Indian Epilepsy Association, especially what they represent, Bamboo Chapter, has taken a lead in all these activities, especially to push the law about epilepsy, and succeeded in marriage law, repealing, and also succeeded in getting a disability for the people of patients with disability to some extent. But still we are unsuccessful in motor vehicle act amendment. They have to struggle for a few more years. Thank you.
Given to either private contractors or to an association. there is a big signage in each and every such swimming pools that people with epilepsy and IHD are not allowed. And can I sue these five organizations which are maintaining it for not allowing the epileptic people or the IHD people possibly? That's the first question. Number two, sir, you said that the giddiness in the transport application form, it was there. If I'm not wrong, you were the director of Nirmans for over 12 years. Have you shot a letter to the transport secretary? You would have made the ball rolling. Why did you not do that?
Shall I take the second one first, because that is more provocative? I have called many people, including the top commissioners, and had discussions repeated. That is what I am saying. 2000, this so much of letters we have done. We have represented up to the parliament, sir. How will you feel a Motor Vehicle Act amendment has taken place in December 2016? Passed in February of 2017, still they don't do nothing. This is nothing important, sir, for them. What is important? This is nothing for them. Who are we? We are common people. So we don't have any voice. That is the issue.
The head of the national level.
No voice, sir. This is what I'm trying to say. A common man is a common man here. Unfortunately, we are in that. 21 years has taken to pass this law, one PWD Act, which was there in 1995, passed in 2017 to revision, and it took 21 years, and I don't know how much we have struggled from, because mental illness has been improved. You know that mental illness is for that we were struggling so much, and we were extremely happy that it was improved. So he said that. That's why I said I'm happy in one way, I'm unhappy in another. At least something we succeeded, and that itself gives a great relief for us. So that is the first thing. We will work hard. We will continue to fight. We will not leave it. I'm sure if I am not there, my next generation people will take it. This goes on. The fight will never end. And Dr. Mani did, Dr. H.V. Srinivas did, we have done. So same way the next generation will take it. We will fight. And we will succeed one day. But that day has to come. That is regarding the second question, which was very, very provocative question. That's why I said. The first question regarding swimming. Yes. Do they can they swim? Absolutely they can swim. What is important? A coach who is there should be aware of his health condition. That this child or this boy or this girl has got a collapse. If they know that, they can definitely supervise. Keep an eye on that. They can swim. There is no problem. But what we want? We want to sit inside the office and the people should be swimming there. That cannot. So if a person can take care of that, the coaches are available there, or a family member, for example.
No, sir. Lifeguard will be
absolutely
in the public patches.
Sir, do you know how many lifeguards will be there? And what are they doing?
About 5 to 6 people.
I know about National College, this swimming pool which is there. This is very good swimming pool, because I used to take my daughter there, so I know fully well about this. And the coaches also I know very well. Pradeep Kumar, who is a very senior coach, I know him very well. So there we have all implemented that. These are all done. But many PPMP swimming pool, unfortunately, has no lifeguard. No coaches there to stand and observe. If there is a coach or a lifeguard available, absolutely no problem. That has to be repeated. That has to be removed. They can't swim because you are taking a life of an individual. Then they can enjoy life. And swimming is very good exercise, and that should be permitted. But there must be somebody who is keeping a watch. What I tell them, my patients, when they come, is, you please go with the patient. And parents, stand there. If there is a child, they want to learn. Somebody is there to look after, no problem. Then they will take, as I said, that these are all once in every lifetime, you get to take a risk. That risk can be taken, provided somebody is alert. As long as somebody is looking after, absolutely there is no contraindication for going ahead with swimming. That's what I have to ask. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, this epileptic patient taking long medicine for long term will get this drowsiness.
All anti- anti-epileptic drug causes drowsiness. Every drug. Some drug causes more, some drug causes less. But what happens is, when you start a drug, it causes drowsiness. After some time, you get used to that. That means that is the reason, one of the basic principles when we start a drug of all epilepsy, start low, go slow. That is then always the quotation which we use. Everything you have to start low, small dosing, build it up. It takes about 2 months sometimes. Some people react very badly. So those patients will take a longer time and use the drug which causes less drowsiness. And especially the alertness. I will give you an example, madam. It is a very good question and again a provoking question. I have a drug which costs 50 paisa per day. And I have a drug which costs you 20 rupees a day. I get a person who is a cattle grazer. That means he goes to the field and graze the cattle. He doesn't have money. And the government, we don't give all free drugs everywhere. So if a person takes a 50 paisa drug, he sleeps 1 hour extra or 2 hours extra. Can he sleep 1 hour extra? What is the hurry? He can take the cattle at 7 o'clock instead of 5 o'clock. He can take at 8 o'clock. There's nothing will happen. On the other hand, if you are a computer engineer, you are a software engineer, you are working very hard, then you have to be alert. Or a VIP, you are a very important person. If you have one attack on a stage, your life is over. That is the problem. So it all depends upon whom we are treating. You have to individualize the treatment when we are talking about drowsiness and the drugs.
Because that patient, if he discontinues one or two...
No, never. You should never discontinue.
He will make the seizure.
Absolutely. We should never discontinue. That is what I am saying. Such patients are called, that belongs to group 2, which I said. Group 2 patients are 20 to 25% of the people where we have to be careful. And such group of people should never drive any vehicle because they are on multiple drugs and that causes drowsiness. So we need to subcategorize these people. That is why we say this group of people should come under Disability Act. But we don't want 75% people to come under Disability Act. We want to avoid that. We always used to say epilepsy should not be discriminated. Epilepsy should not be made as disabled. Only this 20% of the people who are on multiple drugs, which comes in their way of life, should be taken under that.
I have a simple question, sir. The epileptic patient, is there any hold on to for him, or to know that she's going to have a seizure?
That is another important question. This is what is the research of today. Some people with epilepsy get to know their attack. God is great. That person knows that he gets an epilepsy in another few seconds, not minutes. So what they do, I'm walking in the road, I get to know that this is my premonition that I will get an attack. I will just go to the footpath and stand there or lie down or sit so that I will not fall and protect myself without injury. That is one way. That helps. And we also able to say which type of epilepsy has got this premonition. There are different types of epilepsy. Some of these epilepsy has got this premonition, which helps. But what is important is now, we are working on research question now, is that can we predict epilepsy? That is the question which we are asking now. It is just like, can we predict tsunami? We are all talking about it. And the meteorological department, I'm sure you have one meeting, one scientific session on that.
But census of epilepsy.
Few years ago, they were there. Can we predict epilepsy? Can we predict tsunami? If I can predict epilepsy, I can also treat the epilepsy. How can we treat? There are methods which we can stop. It is as simple as watch that. As simple as a pacemaker. When I know that if I get an attack, I just press the button. It gives a stimulus to the brain and it stops the attack. That is what exactly we are aiming at. We have already devised the second half of it. The second half of it means we know that it can be stopped. That's without an injection. We can stimulate that and stop it. But the first half of it, when it will come, we do not know. And that is what is tsunami about. The tsunami I can predict, I can save many things. So similarly, we are also working on various parameters. It is just like forecasting. the forecasting requires so many parameters and then come to a conclusion on a mathematical principle. Similarly, we are also using the pulse, we are using the sweat, we are using other parameters, autonomic disturbances, and then predict certain activity. Current research is on that. And I'm sure a day is not too far where we are able to predict. And once we predict, we can stop. That's what it is.
So in this connection, I just like to share one thing. I was working in a bank. My colleague, who was an epileptic, he was sitting in a corner and waiting to do his work. But when there is some symptom,
he would get.
See, I have observed these symptoms. He would get this saliva.
That is late. That is late.
Mm-hmm. What so we came to know that he is getting the procedure, then we would ask him to lay down. He starts sweating.
As I said, about 30 to 35% of the epilepsy, he gets this premonition. I didn't go into the detail. We can take another class on that. The types of semiology of epilepsy, I have beautiful videos to show now. Then you will all understand what type of epilepsy is it. In certain types of epilepsy, this premonition, what we call as an aura, comes. They know about it. Such cases, they can protect themselves, which is very, very helpful if we know that they know about this. But what we are interested in, the majority of them, they don't know. And those cases, we need to predict. And if I predict, I can stop. That is what is the thing.
Sir, can you feel 500 mg for the morning and the night? And for 3 years I'm taking. So you said after 5 years you can stop it. So is there any side effect if we continue? So that not to take risk to stop it.
Why do you want to take
it? Will there be side effect for me?
Why do you want to take it?
Because I've had a seizure once.
Correct.
But no, the doctor told me not to stop it. So the two options. Some people say
yeah,
paper, some people say
I will not go into the personal thing. Okay. I will make it a general statement. If a person of your age had only one seizure, I don't even start treating. There is no question. I don't even start treatment. The reason for that is your chances of getting a next attack is very, 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 very remote. And after 6 months, your chance is nil. Your chance and my chance, or Ramrao's chance of getting a seizure is same. So that means I also should take the treatment. He also should take the treatment. Then we'll put it in a water and send it to everybody. Come in water, we'll have a victim. That is not the way. We should use the drug if it is required, because every drug has got its side effects. We should never use a drug unnecessarily. These are very important basic principles. Otherwise, I will put the drug in the water. Everybody can take it.
My point is for precaution measures, sir. Because
not required, sir.
It's a dangerous situation.
As I said, your chance of getting an attack and my chance of getting an attack, his chance of getting an attack is same. That means I also should take treatment.
You have not had a seizure before.
No, my chance is equal to yours. That is what I am saying. Your chance done after 3 years is equal to my chance. I also get the chance. You also have a chance. So that means everybody should take treatment. Is it logic there? No. That is the reason you should give a chance is equal to general population chance. That is what we look at chance. Chance means everybody from birth till death can have epilepsy attack. So your chance of getting the next attack and my chance of getting the next attack is same. So what is the point in taking the treatment? There's no point. That is what we do.
Thank you, sir. It's a very good lecture. I want to know if you have said that epilepsy is coming because of some disorder in the electrical activity. So how do we know that he has got a seizure in the sleep? Or whether he is fit to drive, particularly seizures. Is there any normal test?
That is, this is the problem with that quoted. A person with the first lady pilot. Person who doesn't want to reveal can hide the things. And drivers who apply for a job, especially for the public vehicle, if they hide, there is no way you can go on this. And if you are in that situation, imagine yourself what is going to happen. And the classic examples which I gave in front of Vijay College, what has happened, a BMTC bus driver drove and he would have killed so many people. So that is the situation. you must be conscious and you must report saying that you have an attack. Or a doctor who is treating should report. That is what my last statement was there. A medical authority should report. That should be a way out for this. Otherwise, you all hide and you will be driving mainly and cause problems to the society. That's the issue. There is no way. We can do an EEG, we can do stress test like heart attack. You do a stress test. We also, we have a stress EEG. We do that EEG in a situation like a pilot or a driver of a public vehicle. And if there are any abnormalities which comes up, then we don't have it.
Progressive disease and can be fatal? Can be fatal.
It is a chronic disease. It is a chronic neurological condition. It can progress. There are some epilepsy which is a progressive part of disorder. And there are epilepsy which are fatal ones. So all are there. All the three aspects what you said is there. But that is less than 20%. It comes under the group 2, which is 20 to 25%, where we talk about it as it is a disabling type of class. 75% of the people fall under group 1, which doesn't cause any problem. I am very happy because the majority of them are in group 1. Only a small proportion belongs to group 2. Don't punish everybody. Take care of those second.
I think it's time to close this session. Thank you, Doctor. You can come here. No problem.
What is the patient is affected, what is the first step to be done?
That's what I've said. This session is not for that. That's why I did not say. Nothing more to be done. What is important is if a person is getting an epileptic attack, he should be made to lie down on the floor. If they are on the cot or anything, put them on the floor. Turn to one side. Nothing else you have to do. It's not on its own. Right or left. The reason for that is it stops on its own. It takes few seconds. If it is more than 30 seconds, then you need to inform the doctor. If it is most of the attacks last not even 30 seconds, and we have a watch, we can calculate what happened.